Hi, everybody. Dr. Joe Dispenza here. I want to take a moment and teach you some basic tools to begin to change your life. When you invest in yourself, you invest in your future. Take some time out of your busy life to disconnect from your world. Shut your cell phone off, turn the TV off, power down your computer, sit your body down for a few minutes and close your eyes. Take some breaths and center yourself. When you center your attention into the present moment, you have more energy to create with. When your mind wanders to the predictable future or the familiar past, that's normal. Just become aware of it and keep working on settling yourself back down into the present moment. When you're in the present moment, you're the most creative. Ask yourself, can I be defined by a vision of the future instead of the memories of the past? What do I want in my life? Take the time to answer the question. As you begin to contemplate and think about the answer to the question, you're changing your brain. When you make your brain fire in new sequences, patterns, and combinations, that's the beginning steps of changing your mind. Decide on the emotions you'll feel when you begin to create that future. Teach your body emotionally what that future is going to feel like, and don't get up until you begin to feel those emotions. Rehearse in your mind who you're going to be when you open your eyes. The things you have to do, the choices you have to make, the steps you have to take, review them over and over again. You can't go to the future holding onto the biology of your past. Decide what thoughts you can bring to your future. Write them down. Thoughts like, I can't, it's too hard, I'll never change, I'll start tomorrow, what's wrong with me? It's someone else's fault. Decide on what behaviors or actions or unconscious habits you have to change. How do you talk? Do you complain? Do you blame? Do you make excuses? Do you feel sorry for yourself? Just become so conscious of those behaviors that you'll never go unconscious again. Lastly, you have to decide what emotions no longer belong in your future. If you want to be wealthy, you can't take lack. If you want to be healthy, you can't take insecurity or fear. You've got to begin to condition your body to a new mind. If you do this every single day, your personality creates your personal reality. And your personality is made up of how you think, how you act, and how you feel. Change any one of those things, and you change your life. Begin to measure the effects of what you would cause. Give it a shot. Now, there are dangers to being in the present moment. There's dangers to expressing love. There's dangers to trust. Because if you're living in an environment where survival is the credo, you're not going to want to close your eyes and go within. You're not going to want to trust anybody. You know this is not a time really to relax. This is a time to be vigilant. So then people, then they cannot intellectually understand it. But they can't get to that level because they're always perceiving their environment as the jungle. So when we begin to overcome those emotions of stress that are highly addictive, the body is no longer being tormented like an addict. That is when the body liberates energy. And that's when our heart starts to open. And that's when we start to believe in possibility again. So if our personality creates our personal reality, we make a decision first. We examine who we've been, and I call it crossing the river of change from the old self to the new self. Crossing that river is going to be uncomfortable. It's going to feel unfamiliar. And you are going to feel like it's unpredictable because the moment you're no longer thinking that way or acting that way or feeling that way, you're going to feel like an unknown. Now, this is biological, the chemical and even genetic death of the old self. This is the pain that you experience because the body's looking for its familiar chemical state. That pain is normal. And if you understand that, that void, that unknown is the perfect place to create. That's the place you want to create. And not to fear it, but to embrace it, and your body's craving the familiar chemicals that it's addicted to, then you might want to say, when you're in that place, well, the best way to predict my future is to create it, not from the known, but from the unknown. Now, this perfect place of creation is where people begin to do the uncommon. This is where their soul begins to speak to them. This is where they see a greater purpose for themselves in their lives. And they're no longer playing by the small-minded games any longer because they're connected to some bigger vision. I think transformation is really the one thing that I'm more passionate about than anything else. And so I think taking time out of our busy day for ourselves is the greatest service that we can do for ourselves, for our family, for the people we work with, and for our community. If most people's attention is on their external environment, on their body and on time, and they wake up every morning and they get out of bed and they do the same thing they've been doing for the last 20 years, and their body is already programmed into a predictable future. Their body's already on autopilot. They have thought of the coffee pot. And the next thing they know, they have coffee in their hand. They haven't thought of the shower. The next thing they know, they're in the shower. They've thought about going into work. The next thing they know, they're in the car. So their body is following their mind. If they're living by the same emotions every single day, then their body, for the most part, is in the past, because emotions are a record of the past. So finding the sweet spot of the present moment in our meditation is so highly important, because the body has been trained to be in the future. So then most people, they take their meditation and they stick it in as another thing to do so they don't have to feel guilty. That's not the answer either. Working with your body and understanding that it's the animal. And we do this in our workshops. We make people. We don't make them. We ask them in their meditations to really get to that point where they're unfolding in that infinite field of potentials as thought alone. In other words, if you're going to heal yourself by thought alone or create something in your life by thought alone, then you have to become thought alone. This is the key element where all of a sudden now, when you keep practicing bringing your body back into the present moment and you become aware of that, it's thinking about, what about this thing I have to do? This plan I have to catch? This contract I have to sign? And that person I have to call? That's a predictable future. And you become aware that you're investing your energy into that reality, because where you place your attention is where you place your energy. Or you're living by some emotion of impatience or frustration or vigilance, then you're siphoning energy out of the present moment and you have no energy to create with. So every time you become conscious that you're moving out of the present moment, and just like riding an unbridled stallion, every time you bring that body back into the present moment and you relax it back down into the present moment and you surrender into nothing, every time you do that, you're reconditioning your body to a new mind. In other words, you're not allowing your body to become the mind. Now, people will say, well, that's going to take a lot of work. And I say to them, well, what's the alternative? And you want to do drugs. I mean, nothing is going to help you to get to the present moment but you. And if you practice being present every single day in your meditations, you will be more present in your life and less preoccupied with that worst case scenario, that moment where something could go wrong. And living by those hormones, their stress, and your body then finally starts to trust you. And when your body finally starts to trust you is the moment it's not worried about the unknown. The unknown. So we do the work every day to present ourselves as a greater expression of ourselves every day. And in the beginning, it will feel unnatural. It will feel uncomfortable. But I swear there's been hundreds of people once they start seeing the effects and they find true joy within them because they're pleased with themselves and they got beyond themselves. I mean, in the brain scans that we studied with people, I can tell you that when people get beyond themselves, they are so incredibly powerful. The self that's attached to the emotional body, that's attached to the pain, that's attached to the past. And then, by the way, they tell the story based on those emotions. And Scientific American said 3 months ago that 95% of everything that people talk about in their past is a lie. It's not the truth, because they have a different brain today than they did at the time of the event. So getting people beyond their past, I think, and getting them into the present moment begins to liberate the most amount of energy. I think people are beginning around the world to wake up to the idea that the illusion is becoming so obvious. I mean, every single paradigm right now is collapsing. Whether it's the political model, the economic model, the religious model, the medical model, the educational model, environment, everything's collapsing right now because it cannot function on the old laws, the old paradigm. Something new has to be created. So then how do we begin to become supernatural? We have to begin to do what's unnatural. And if when everybody else is in lack and in poverty, that is the time to give. When everybody else is in fear and worried, that's the time to demonstrate courage. When everybody else is judging and worrying, that's the time to show love and compassion. And if we keep doing the unnatural long enough, sooner or later, we'll begin to become supernatural. Our soul's journey then is to really step out of the quagmire and the limited beliefs and perceptions that keep us playing in this limited realm, this limited density where we are matter trying to change matter. Once we get a taste of the divine, and that divine, again, we've measured this over and over again. When you are that thought in that infinite space, when the brain is perceiving space and no longer perceiving objects, it gets very organized, it gets very coherent. And when the brain gets coherent, when the heart gets coherent, we love way more. And that's when we begin to emulate the divine. So over and over again, as we begin to climb out of these limited states and we break free from those survival emotions that keep us feeling more like matter and less like energy, the side effect of all of that is becoming more energy and less matter. And that's when we start to demonstrate being a vibrational being. The field around our bodies when we're living in stress is about 3 to 4 inches in size. Open your heart. It can be up to 9 meters wide. We've measured. And so then when you begin to open your heart, you feel connected to something greater. That's the beginning. That's when the soul says, now I have infinite possibilities to experience, and I get to select as a free, win-free world individual where I want to place my attention. That's when we're liberated. So I think it's a great time for us to begin to really embody this information. I think it's a great time for us to hit the low points, to see those illusions. I mean, I had my own awakening, and you reach a point where you realize that the only time that you feel like yourself is you need the external world to remind you of it. That's a sign. When you can find an identity of yourself in the quietness and solitude of your own presence, that's when you're no longer seduced by the external world. And that's when you begin to experience true freedom.